Okay. Yeah, just on that front, well, I've been meaning to say, and I'm just remembering that if you're a Facebook user, do join the Vajraloka Facebook group, because we put updates and nice pictures of how things are at Vajraloka and other stuff. So it'd be good to have as many people as wish to part of that group. Okay. So last session, and I wanted to, well, I mean, I was going to say I wanted to do a bit of a summary, but actually, effectively, I've been doing an ongoing summary day by day. So we've been going through the whole integrated mandala, and we will do that. But yesterday, I tried to do it quite, in a quite epitomized way, and it turned out to be less epitomized than I meant it to be. So I'm going to do it in a fairly epitomized way today. And then I just want to explore one or two more areas with regard to the center of the mandala, which is receptivity or just sitting or simply being. So we'll just go into a little bit more there. And then, well, we'll see what unfolds, but there could be a bit of discussion around that. And I want to allow time before the end for anyone to ask any questions that you wish. So that's what we're going to do. Also, yeah, it was a somewhat flagged up as what to do with all this stuff afterwards, or when you're not actually on a even a virtual retreat. So I will say a little bit about that as well. Okay, so let's do a short meditation. So, as usual, just sitting. Just to check how it is with mind and body and the other sense fields. And then, whatever's going on with the mind, simply bringing awareness into the soma. And you could bring awareness directly down to the sensations of grounding. So, immediately and effortlessly, awareness can just be there. So on one level, we're sensing the effect of gravity. And we're also sensing our contact with our grounding in the earth, in the earth element, in the earth itself. And then using a couple of breathings up from the earth to bring more energy and lift into the soma, into the body. Checking the alignment of the head by checking the chin is not too far out or too far in, and checking the alignment of the upper body just by subtly moving back and forth, left and right. finding poise. And the lift and poise enables letting go. Just letting go of whatever doesn't need to be held on to. And being the whole body, being the whole somatic cloud. And then if you feel the mind would settle more by bringing awareness into the hara, do by all means. Or if you wish, just follow the breath. And remain in the whole sense of the somatic cloud. Just decide for yourself what will enable the mind to settle a bit more. And allowing awareness to be present in the sensations just where they are, rather than being situated exclusively in the head. Awareness fills the whole body, the whole soma. And then within this cloud of body sensations, bring awareness into the heart center. Just locate where it intuitively feels to be. Is the heart relatively open or contracted, or where in between? And if you let the awareness come into that area behind and possibly slightly below the heart center, notice what effect that has on the quality of the heart center. And again, checking that you really feel you are in the heart center rather than what's probably the usual location in the head. The heart is the center of your being in many ways. Now just opening to a sense of sensitivity, kindness, warmth, goodwill, love. Bearing in mind, as I said yesterday, that our very motivation for doing this is ultimately love and compassion. That is manifesting here already. Noticing whether the heart responds to that love, to that metta. Or whether it now seems to arise from the heart in some way. Or possibly that won't be the case. Love is still there. And then just letting go of any sense of it having boundaries or edges. Just let it be unlimited and all-inclusive. And you could sense that just as the metta is unbounded, so is the soma. Somatic space is also unbounded. So you can have a sense of the somatic space and the unbounded metta together. And you could also notice we've been looking at inside and outside. Well, the metta has no inside or outside, as well as this sense of somatic space in which the sensations of the body are arising. So it might be another way of getting a sense of no inside, no outside. A unified space of being, so to speak, of wholeness. Undividedness. And you could also notice how the space, the sphere of sounds is just the same space and just as undivided. So this is all recollecting what we've already done over the previous days. So potentially there's a sort of integration of an undivided space of metta, somatic space, space of sounds, just rest in that sense of space. Spaciousness. But maybe just very intuitively and without using the thinking mind, sense how the other sense fields are also arising in the same space. So we could call it the space of awareness. Another way of referring to it. And then let go of any effort to control anything or make anything happen or not happen. Just be whatever it is, whatever's here. Okay, so I touched on most of the aspects of the dynamic mandala. As I've said before, I don't particularly emphasize the rebirth aspect because that will happen if it happens. It will be part of it if you like, if you're opening out to what's being pointed to. I just wanted to mention that remember that the Dharma is a raft. The Dharma, as described by the Buddha, is something which, if you like, was put together to get us there. And where is there? Well, I mean, one way in which the Buddha talked about it was in terms of the unborn, the unmade, the unbecome, the unconditioned. These are ways of talking about nirvana or nibbana. And well, that's where it's pointing. That's the realization which brings the cessation of dukkha, the cessation of suffering. So it's like we can't make that happen, but we may find that at moments we just open to it. It's just there. But the point about the raft is that everything we do in terms of everything I've been teaching this week, everything I've been talking about, all of it is a means to an end. All of the the basic practices that we do in Sri Ratna, the mindfulness of breathing, the metta bhavana, your various insight practices, sadhana, just sitting, they are all a means to an end. And none of them have a kind of absolute status. They're all there for us to make our own and explore. And they're also there for us to, in a way, to find whether or not they work for us. And in what way they work for us. So I really want to just re-emphasize the importance of exploring, finding out how, the way in which these principles can best be embodied. So integration, it might work fine for some people through, the four-stage mindfulness of breathing that we generally teach, or it might be something much more in the sort of general somatic way that I've been presenting. There are many, many different ways in which we can approach just that one principle of integration, embodiment, becoming present, entering into what I've been calling basic presence, just where we are basically present in our experience. So the question there is, what enables me to become basically present in experience without being caught up in the mind all the time? And really, really explore, really find out what works. And it's not always going to be the same thing. It's not like you just find it and then that's it. You're always on the right track. We often find that we have to change our approach from time to time. Anyway, so that's a sort of general thing. Now, I did want to do at least one more exercise with you. You could say this is sort of in the area of spiritual death, but it's also very pertinent to the center of the mandala, to just sitting, to formless meditation, to simply being. And is to orientate ourselves towards our experience in the light of our concept of time. Now, we take it for granted that time is something in which we exist. For instance, I can look at the clock and see that we've got about 32 minutes left of this session. So, I mean, we're not denying time in the clock sense or in the making appointments sense, but what we're going to do is just look at our experience in the light of our concept that somehow we're experiencing in time. So it's a way of becoming clearer experientially about what the nature of our experience actually is. Okay, so we'll just do a short exercise on this. So You can sit in your meditation posture and shut your eyes if you wish. And just settle as much as possible, just settle into where you were. Just notice your experience as it is. And you might get a sense that experience is like a flow or a stream. And that flow is sort of coming from the past and moving into the future. So that's one way of looking at it. But consider, what is your actual experience now? And I emphasize your actual experience now of anything past. So I'm specifically excluding memory. And just to be clear, I'm excluding also the effects, for instance, in your body of past experiences. I'm talking about, if you like, consciousness. So what is our consciousness of the past directly right now? Can we experience anything which is gone into the past? See if you can do it. For instance, can you somehow go back and experience the out-breath that you had before the current one? Okay, now the same with regard to the future. With the same or similar provisos, of course, we can think about the future. Some people might even have what might be regarded as precognitive events. But can you actually experience anything in the future right now? In exactly the same way that you are experiencing whatever is here right now. Not imagining it, actually experiencing it. Okay, now, can you find a present moment? Can you grasp a present moment? Okay, now stop even trying to do that and simply be. Be whatever you actually are. And be, so to speak, exactly when you are. Okay, so feel free to come back into timeless presence sometime later, but we need to move towards a conclusion. Could everyone still hear me?
Hi. Can I just ask you something?
Hi.
You said something about some people might experience a precognitive, something about what a precognitive experience of the future. I wasn't quite sure what you meant by
that. Well, precognitions are when somebody foresees something, which later may or may not prove to happen.
Right.
So, you know, it's regarded as a, what do you say,
it's
a sort of super, it's a unusual. Precognition.
A premonition, like a premonition, the same as a premonition.
Yeah, okay, thank you. So I was just excluding that from the inquiry. So any comments or observations?
Yeah, I was just going to say that I found the sense of time seems to create as quite a strong sort of sense of craving or pressure, the pressure of time.
Yes.
And going into the future. So as a meditation, it really helped me to, my sort of thinking slowed down quite significantly. That's great.
Oh, right. Yeah. Yeah, that's good. Well, another thing you can do, Ed, is to, you know, when you come into that, well, let's call it that place, notice the nature of the thinking that's happening right now. Yeah, is there any thinking that you can identify actually happening right now? You know, so it's another way of also inquiring into the nature of thinking.
Excellent. Okay.
Hi. Yeah, it was really interesting. Clearly, I couldn't really find the past. I couldn't really find the future. When I tried this to find the present, I wasn't sure if I was just experiencing the very, very near past, because by the time you've become aware of something, it's already gone. So I was getting myself a bit caught up in, am I just experiencing the very near past? Is that what present experience is? But then just to kind of open out into it just took all that kind of complication away.
Yeah. In what way?
Well, it becomes just a kind of field of awareness. It's hard to describe. So it hasn't got a kind of time element to it, I suppose.
Right, yeah. Well, that's good. I mean, one point I could make about this is that we're never experiencing anything other than what we're experiencing.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, that thing about, are we experiencing the very near past? We might be remembering it quite vividly at that moment, but we're not actually experiencing it. What we're experiencing right then is a memory of it.
Yeah.
A vivid memory of it. Yeah. So, you know, that applies right across the board. It's like we're only experiencing what we're experiencing. Everything else, well, this is where it gets interesting, because where is everything else? I'll leave that as an open question. Any more observations?
Can I just ask you just to clarify something quickly that you said to Ed? I kind of
lost. Sorry, Keith, I couldn't quite hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
It was just when you were speaking to Ed and answering his query, I missed a bit of it. Then I heard you saying, just look to see if there's any thinking that's going on right now. Could you tell me why you said that? Because I missed the context of why you said that.
Yes, I was saying that if with that exercise, if you got the point of it, you'll find that you can't find an experience of time. Yeah. There's simply what you call presence. Okay. Now, if you get to that point in which there's just presence and you're not projecting into the past or the future, notice what's happening with the thinking at that very moment.
Ah, okay. Yeah.
So that was the suggestion.
Thank you.
The question that came to my mind was, how long is a moment? Because a breath takes a length of time, and I'm aware that I'm breathing in and I'm aware that I'm breathing out, and that's within a time. So that to me seemed to have a time. Is that not valid?
Mm. Well, I would say that's a very clear example of the way in which we impute time into our experience. You know, it would seem that it's like when you're experiencing the beginning of the out-breath, you're not experiencing the end of the out-breath. Yeah. And when you're experiencing the middle of the out-breath, you're not experiencing the beginning or the end. So what's happening is that the mind is construing a time length in which the out-breath takes place. But your actual experience isn't of the whole out-breath all at once. It can't be. Yeah, so I mean that you, if you go into that, you can find out, you know, that's a good way of exploring the way in which we create a sense of time. And I mean, as I'm saying, it's not that there's anything wrong with having a sense of time, it's just that we can notice that it is simply something which we're imputing rather than something which is real.
But even to use the term moment is the time concept, isn't it?
Yes, well, unfortunately, there are no words which really work for timelessness. Yeah, you can say timelessness, but, you know, in some way, I mean, people use different concepts like the moment, the now, but all of them are meant to point to the fact that our actual experience is always timeless. Yeah, we're not experiencing the future, we're not experiencing the past, and we can't even find something called the present moment. Yeah, so yeah, that's what we're getting at. And as I say, this is not a kind of this is not a theoretical or philosophical exercise. It's a way of getting to how things actually are. Yeah, it's, if you like, another way of putting that would be is getting to the very nature of awareness directly and experientially. Potentially.
Thank you.
Is there a practical upshot of this realization? Eckhart Tolle notwithstanding.
Well, the practical outcome would be some kind of insight, if you like.
Yeah. Okay. Could I?
This is a.
Sorry.
Yeah, go on.
Sorry, can I quickly make a comment? Is the time? I experienced quite a lot of sadness actually, and I found it quite difficult when I realized that the past wasn't accessible anymore in experience. I felt quite sad. What I realized was that I'm always kind of thinking that my experience as it is isn't enough. It's not good enough somehow. Mm-hmm. So I'm kind of craving the past or looking at the future all the time. And it felt quite sad.
Yeah.
But then when you said, try just being, I realized that actually when I was in the past, so to speak, then I was just experiencing then anyway. So I always am just experiencing. So it is good enough. But there was a long moment of real sadness, kind of like loss or something.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's a very apposite observation there, Paula. And we don't experience anything other than what we're experiencing now. We can live in a whole imaginative realm in which can be very rich, and in a way there's nothing wrong with that, except to the extent that it's a way in which we cause dukkha, suffering, to ourselves. Because it's gone actually. So the Dharma is directing us into things as they really are. And things as they really are, this is one way of getting to what actually is right now. And yes, it means letting go of things as well. I mean, we know that the Dharma does involve renunciation, but fundamentally it involves renunciation of whatever it is that gives rise to suffering. That's all that we're renouncing. And we're left with what we always were. And that's the crucial point. This is what we actually are. We're not creating or construing something. In a way, we're coming to the Buddha's teaching to Bahya, in the scene, just what is seen, just what is heard, just what is sensed, just what is cognized. That's what we're coming into, potentially.
Can I say something? Can you hear me?
I can.
Yeah. So what happened for me was that I heard that I was given permission when you talked about the past, and a memory came up that was really beautiful memory about my mother that I'd never allowed myself to look at. And then when I recognized a memory, I was by then in a state of tears and sadness, but that was what was present. So to let go of something, you have to have had it. And it felt like I had permission somehow or other to time travel to the past, which was real, which I'd not allowed myself to do. So I would time as being able to go back in time in a memory and experience something rather than projecting onto something. It felt very real. So.
Right. Yeah, well, I mean, I think in another sense, it's absolutely fine and important to be able to do that, with regard to the past. So if that sort of helps you break down some sort of obstruction to doing that, that's great. At the same time, as regards the practice that we're doing here, which is pertinent to the center of the mandala, because the center of the mandala is always and only timeless. It's always and only this. And, within this, all of these memories and anticipations can happen. So it's not that one kind of negates the other. It's just noticing what the case actually is, and that, memories are memories, and they're happening now. And all sorts of other experiences are happening now, but memories aren't actually happening now. We're just having a memory of something that happened.
Can I ask something?
Yeah, go on.
Is it Tejananda?
Who's that?
It's Padma Vantri.
Oh, Padma Vantri. Sorry, my screen almost frozen up.
So my experience was of a sort of discontinuity. It was quite strange. Like, the more I tried to find the past and the future, it was like on another plane. I can't really think of another word. And then when I was looking for the present moment, it was like a torrent, actually, of experience. I can't really describe it any, like a very fast river or a waterfall of sensations. I didn't really know quite what to do with that other than just let it flow.
I mean, that's what I was referring to by flow. There's just a sense of flow happening, stuff is happening all the time, and what to do with it, don't do anything with it, just let it be.
That's the job. That's the task, isn't it?
Yeah, just let it be.
Can I say something?
Sure.
I found it was very difficult. It was when you took us into now. I couldn't get, how long is now? It just kept disappearing. So this flow state really, really hit me. And I just was like, oh my goodness. And it just, you couldn't find it. I couldn't find now. Now didn't exist. And that was just a really interesting place to be. It's the first time I've really experienced that. So thank you very much. I will revisit it, I think.
Good. Yeah. Well, I mean, really, that is, that is the point I was trying to get you to. It's not a conceptual point, and it's an experiential point. And there is no now. Sorry?
It was very much experiential. Very difficult to articulate it.
Right. Can I just say,
a few more minutes. So if anyone wanted to bring in a more general question, or, do feel free to do so. But I'm open to comments about the exercise we just did as well.
Hello, Tejananda. Tejananda, can you hear me?
Hello.
Hello, this is Richard.
Okay,
I'll press ahead with my question, assuming I can be heard. Throughout the week, I've been...
Just about.
Okay, throughout the week, I've been a little troubled by the way you've described the mind and the head as locations for conceptual thought. Because I would say that all consciousness is located in the mind, and we perceive bodily sensations through neurons communicating to the brain. And when you introduced the heart center, you distinguished it from the physical heart, and yet you were keen for us to locate it within the physical body. So I'd just like you to talk a bit more about, are you positing a very radical alternative science, or to what extent are you using metonyms, please?
Using what?
Metonyms, metaphors.
I'm not familiar with that word.
Well, metaphor.
Oh, right, okay. I've been using metaphor quite a lot, but I'm not talking about science at all. I'm not using a neurological model. I'm using a Dharma model of our experience. So, but just to clarify one thing, when I talk about mind, I mean the mental activities. Yeah, I mean thinking, imagining, conceptualizing, remembering, all of these are mental activities, and there are many more ways in which we can categorize them. I didn't mean mind in the sense of awareness. Yeah, those, very often in Buddhism, mind includes both mental activities and awareness. But when I say mind, I always, almost always mean mental activity.
Thank you.
You raised quite a few more things there, but I'm afraid there's a bit too much to go into right now. Okay. So any more?
Yeah, Tejananda. On the subject of just sitting, is it possible to access the first dhyana through just sitting rather than doing it through access concentration by mindfulness? In other words, getting piti and sukha through just sitting.
Yes, it is. Sorry, I'm getting an echo here as well now. So you can access some absorption through just sitting. It's possible, but it's maybe not the most efficient way to go about it, because if you're really just sitting, you're just allowing whatever happens to happen on a kind of ongoing basis. And that could include a lot of unfocused thinking going on. So, I mean, that's why I would recommend building up the sense of the dynamic mandala before you go into just sitting. And then you may find that you're getting quite absorbed, at least into the state that I've been calling basic presence, which is the same as access. And from access, you can go where you like, basically. You can go into dhyana, you can go into insight reflection, you can go into just sitting.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, now we're getting very, very close to the end, and I would have liked to have just had another little couple of minutes of sitting, but I think we just haven't really got time for that. And furthermore, the connection, I'm afraid, is so poor. I hope everyone has been able to at least hear this. But I'd just like to recommend to everybody that you explore these things, explore these different ways of approaching our system of practice, or what I prefer to call the five principles of practice that we engage with. And you just find what works for you, what doesn't work for you, and use it if it's useful. But I think the way of approaching it in an integrative way is very useful. I found it very useful personally. So do continue to explore that at times, as well as exploring those five principles individually.